All right. Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Yeah? Thank you so much.
Higher?
Hi, everyone. So great to have you here tonight. I'm Angela Maddox, and I'm the Artistic Director of PICA. And we want to welcome you to our announcement of the Precipice Fund grantees and Winter Social. This is one of our favorite events here at PICA. We are all in pretty desperate, dire need for some inspiration. And always, every year, this group of grantees never ceases to really inspire us with their imaginations, their visions, their rigor, and I think really reinvigorate our notion of what it means to live in this region. I'm so incredibly proud to be a part of this community and to continue to be curious about it and to continue to nurture new perspectives around what's happening in the city and in the state. It's an exciting time to live here and be a culture and art worker in this time. Also tonight, it's really about a thank you. You know, we work with so many of you in the room. As I look around, there's so many artists that have given so much. There's so many board members, audience members, and we don't say thank you enough. And I'm personally just honored to work alongside of you in this work that we do together. And I'm really excited about what we can do together, what we need to do together. Many of you know that PICA is has an incredible opportunity around a new home, which means for the next 2 decades, we'll be inhabiting an extraordinary building in Northeast Portland that will hopefully be a hub for all of you to gather. And we need those spaces right now to gather in the name of imagination, progressive thought, free expression. And we want to be that home for all of you. And so right now we're in this transition moment, because I know a lot of you are going to ask, like, right now we are, we're going to be here for a few months. We're going to do a bit of a renovation in the new home. So this winter and early spring, know that we're going to be busy. We're in research mode. We are running artist residency programs, focusing on exchange and related public programs. And then know that come spring, we'll welcome you into our new home with exhibitions and performances and conversation. And we can't wait for you to really inhabit that space in the way that you did this one. So tonight is actually also maybe a bit of a send-off to this home. It's been amazing, and I'm so happy you're with us. It's been a very special home for us, and let's enjoy the night and each other. I really appreciate you being here. So with that, I want to welcome our visual art curator, Kristen Kennedy, who's going to walk you through more in the evening. Thank you for being here so much. Okay.
I just want to echo some of Angela's sentiments, all of Angela's sentiments, but really just looking out in this room way back there, hello everyone, and say that we love you all. We're really happy that you're here. The thing that I've heard more in the last couple of days about 2016 is that everybody's waiting for it to end. But something really amazing happened this year in 2016, a real huge dream of PICA's and a lot of people in the community. Through generosity of Ali Ferlati, we have a new building. And so as much as I want to toss a lot of the things that happened in 2016 out of the window, I really want to hold on to also all of the incredible things that were made by many of you in this room, experiences, exhibitions, performances, club nights, everything. And that's what we have to keep holding on to. So I'll just say a few things. When we named the Precipice Fund, there was sort of a lot of conversation about whether or not that was a pejorative, like a precipice, like it sounded dangerous, you know. And the edge of a cliff is precarious. But the view there is beautiful, and there's limitless potential. The energy it takes to balance on that cliff is massive, and it is exhausting and exhilarating. And precipice is like one part of the safety net that exists at that precipice. The rest of that fabric is made up of the audience and the friends and the sheer luck and magical thinking of what it means to present and make artwork. All of that together is really strong stuff. And what are we talking about protecting when we talk about protecting the things that are on the precipice? We're talking about the kinds of projects that Precipice funds, and all of the applicants, you know, their projects as well, and all the artists in the room that make work. We're talking about nightlife. We're talking about social justice. We're talking about weird things, intellectual things, free schools, interventions, virtual reality spa situations, mini museums, garage galleries, internet aware, indigenous aware, queer aware, disability aware, black and brown aware, socially engaged artwork. We're talking about publications, festivals, residencies, aesthetic protests, protests, exhibitions, gatherings and spaces, and projects and spaces that promote healing, community, communing, criticality, experimentation, transgressiveness, and interactiveness, togetherness. So, you know, when we think about the world and the country, we're really scared, but I'm not scared when I think about what's in this room. So we have to look inward, we have to look to the local, we have to think about the projects that are rising up, we have to think about the projects that are leaving. Some of us got an email in our inbox this week about Work Sound International, which is closing a really critical space to this region. I just want to thank them, Cherry and Lucic, Muscle Beach, all these other spaces that were here and gone over the last 21 years I've been here, and longer for some of you who've lived here longer. So I want to do an experiment right now. It's weird because I don't like participatory things, sorry. But I want us to think of a space or an artist or a project that was in this town that is now gone, that was really critical to us, and just shout it out on three. Ready? One, two, three.
Work Sound!
Elvis!
Amazing noise. Okay, and now I want us to shout out a name of an artist, a person, a place, a thing, an art space that's really critical to you right now that you want to see survive this next year. Shout it out. That's what we sound like. And Work Sound's email also had something really critical in it. Modu and his collaborators talked about how they were now gonna make the work and the sound. And so Precipice funds projects that are interstitial at the boundaries of a lot of genres, and some of them are really temporary. They last for one night, they last for a week, they last for a year, they last for 5 years, they become nonprofits, they close, but they're all made by artists who have their own individual practices and are coming together to collaborate in this moment in time. And so as much as we mourn the loss of these spaces, I'm also so happy for the artists that made them, that they'll be able to concentrate on their own critical practice, and that we'll be able to support them at all these new Precipice Award grantee spaces, and we'll be able to support them at our institutions and with our patronage and our memberships and our money and our time and all of that. As we go into 2017, the artists and culture workers and their audiences and allies need to work against the threats to our values and protect our fragile communities and work against any efforts to implement policy or people who may threaten human rights or the experimentation of artists that will threaten the progressive values that we share. So keep shouting the names of those artists and others that are working for you and your community. Stand beside them, support them, and this is one way we're all going to survive together. I'm really excited and honored to be here tonight. It's also one of my favorite nights of the year. This is work that PICA really believes in, and it's work that I know that you all believe in. And I'm also really excited to welcome Roya Amir Soleimani, who really is the person who runs the Precipice Fund here at PICA. She's my compatriot. And Roya, will you come up and say a few words?
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Kristen and Angela. I think you're going to find a lot of similar themes and sentiments running throughout the night. And it's just because this is the moment when we need to talk about our work and why we do what we do, and why we come together for this kind of thing and everything else that means so much to us. So if you hear a little repetition, it's because it's that moment for reverberation and resounding support for all of what you in this room do and what you stand for. So thank you for being here. And also thank you again to the Andy Warhol Foundation for the visual arts, to Ali for Lottie, and the Calligram Foundation. This program would not exist without them. And I also want to give a shout out to Nico Rivas, who was our Precipice Fund intern this year. So thank you to all of those people and organizations for making this a reality. Precipice Fund strives to cultivate a culture of grant making that values community over competition. Yes, we want to see money reach artists, but we also want artists across the region to become aware of each other and their relationship to a broader community of experimental, radical collaborators who are pushing formal and conceptual boundaries, challenging the art world status quo, responding to the urgency of our social and political moment, and contributing criticality, rigor, and feeling to our city and region. We really do want to recognize and thank all of the applicants for this round. Kristen said this eloquently earlier, there's never enough funding to go around, and this year was especially competitive. So we're incredibly excited by the diversity of artists and projects that we're seeing being produced throughout the region, including the hubs of Astoria and Eugene Springfield that we expanded to last year. So you're gonna see some representation from those areas tonight. We also strive for an applicant experience that is worthwhile, one that ensures there is an opportunity to meet other artists, to build a relationship with PICA, to practice grant writing and budgeting for those who are new to the process, and to position their project ideas and artistic practices in front of an influential panel. So we hope all of the applicants felt that this year, that value, and I want to give a round of applause to everyone who put in the time and effort to apply. This year, in round four, we received 73 submissions, and just over 20% of them were able to be funded, but it's an amazing group of grantees. We convened an external panel of visual artists, curators, arts administrators, both local and visiting, to make the award decisions. In the end, selecting 17 projects for grants ranging from $3,000 to $5,000 each, for a total of $75,000 in funding. Yes. Our 2016 panelists were Elizabeth Chodos, the executive director of Oxbow School and Artist Residency Program in Saugatuck, Michigan, which is a part of the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. Ryan Dennis, public art director and curator of Project Row Houses in Houston, Texas. Jeff Yon, art critic, writer, and curator here in Portland. And Carly Smith, who's a past Precipice Fund grantee with the project One Flaming Arrow, which is a festival of indigenous contemporary and experimental art. She's also the new board president of Milepost 5 here in Portland and is part of a committee I sit on racial equity in the arts. And I would like to invite Carly and Jeff, our local panelists, up now to say a few words about their experience serving on the panel and something significant that they found within the scope of applicants and grantees. So, Jeff and Carly.
So great to be able to do this tonight. It was such an incredible process to go through with the Precipice Fund grants, partially because Portland as an arts ecosystem is under such incredible pressure, such as it's never faced before. And a lot of us are doing a lot of soul searching, trying to figure out what is important to us. What do we want to protect? What do we want to infuse? How do we want to continue to be a non-linear, asymmetrically thinking arts hub? And what I thought was so great about this particular panel, and the four of us couldn't be any more different from one another, was how everybody sort of inspired us to act almost like a jazz quartet, or it really was a quartet, with Kristen sort of coming in and giving us guidance, but at the same time, we were able to improvise and come up with our own criteria halfway through the process, which really made those people who we did, and projects which we did eventually choose, which was very difficult, allowed us to choose the ones that we had the most passion for. And I just wanted to say that for those people who did not receive a grant, I'll answer questions of any of you about the process. Definitely apply again. So many people and projects were so close, and the smallest hair separated all of you. And it was really inspiring to see all of the outpouring of ideas that were put into this. And I hope that the Precipice Fund continues to influence other granting organizations and other grant processes to think in more non-linear and more, to create a more diverse ecosystem within Portland, because it is threatened.
So I don't have a long piece to say tonight. I just wanted to let all of you know that the work that you're doing is so important right now. And at this moment in Portland, we're in unceded Chinook and Multnomah lands. I just want to say that. For us to be able to support your projects, your plans, your dreams, and making that all a reality, I couldn't think of a better way to spend my time and my energy than on all of you, and to help you all grow your vision, help you all grow and meet each other and work with each other and find each other. And I just want to say, like Jeff, there were so many projects here that were incredible. And if I had unlimited money, I would have granted, being a part of giving you all the chance to realize what it is your projects were, what it is your art was. And so with that, I just want to say thank you. It was such an honor to be able to read your submissions and to be able to do this work for PICA and the Precipice Fund, who I owe a lot to as a past grantee. So I just want to say thank you, all of you, for doing the work that you do. I'm not an artist. It says in here that I'm an artist. I'm not an artist. I'm an organizer. I'm other things. I'm a business person. And I could never do what it is you do. You become this supernatural self when you make your art and you create these things in the world. And it is an honor to be able to witness it and to be able to support it. Thank you.
All right, so a few more remarks and we'll get to the guests of honor. Thank you so much, Carly and Jeff. It was really a pleasure working together to realize tonight's grantees. So before we segue into presentations, just a note about what's going to be happening this evening. As I said, there are 17 grant recipients. They're each going to be giving a brief or approximately 2-minute presentation to share a preview of the project that they've been funded for. And we're going to be going in alphabetical order by project title, which is the same order that you have in your program. And there are more programs in the back where the check-in station is if you don't have one. And then we're going to segue around 7:45. We're going to transition into our winter social, which is PICA's end of year celebration and party for all of you. I hope you'll stay. There's going to be cocktails, tamales, dancing, hopefully, kind of depends on all of you. And then Shannon Funches is going to be our first DJ. She's already been up there and around from Light Asylum. And then from 10 p.m. to midnight, we have DJ Cliff. So stay late and join in the revelry. So now, thrilled to be announcing our 2016 Round 4 Precipice Fund grantees. I want to say a couple of things about what it means to me to be bringing these people together and supporting them. These artists would be making their exhibitions, their performances, their artist-run spaces, their publications, their events, their programs, their websites, their workshops, their conversations, their installations, their festivals, and their itinerant projects come to life with or without this grant. They do it no matter what. But with it, we hope to ease some of the financial burden. We hope it lends visibility and credibility to projects that often fly under the radar. It helps to generate new collaborative and experimental projects and connect artists to each other. And often for the first time, we find that artists don't necessarily run in the same circles or know each other, and we're introduced to a lot of artists this way too, which is thrilling. This year's grantees represent some of the most exciting, independent, experimental artistic activity happening locally. Each of them, in their own way, is attending to the complexity of the now through aesthetics, politics, and the imperative of community awareness. In this unprecedented moment marked by the election, the extremities of violence against people of color, housing crises, economic disparity, environmental degradation, and so much more, supporting artists is more critical than ever. I sent a personal invitation to some of you for tonight's event and expressed a sentiment I want to end with now. May we persist in our fight, remembering artists are integral to and inextricable from resilience and reimagining. May we aspire to future art worlds that resist rather than replicate or exaggerate the inequities and injustices of the world at large. Thank you to all of the artists who are actively doing this work. The Precipice Fund is just one small token of our deep gratitude for what you do in this world. And with that, I want to get to the presentations. So. Our first grantee is Art Writers Tiny Residency, Peter Simensky and Sampada Aronke.
Thanks, Roya. Kristen, Angela, everybody.
Everyone's looking so fly on this Tuesday night in this room. What a great place to be. So Peter and I came together, we're really grateful that we got funded for this project. I live in Oakland, Peter lives here, and we kind of share a lot of conversations around how space is a real crisis in both of our cities. And just as the dream of the artist studio is dying, so too is the dream of the writer's residency. So we came together to curate what is the Art Writer's Tiny Residency Program. We'll be hosting three art writers. That's our photo. It's so boring. Peter's an artist, too.
So this is a residency that's run out of the back of an existing space, which is my studio. So it's a way of using the space and opening the space up to actually encourage others. We're going to be hosting an open studio for that's open to the public, and a way to share what the artist writer is doing over the course of the short residency.
And we're focusing on art writers that do work on contemporary artists of color, mostly. So trying to build out that long-standing historical relationship between artists and writers, and we're really excited about it. So, thank you.
All right, Bud Clark Commons Television.
Yeah!
David Boston, Daniel Michael Greenley, Ray Ricardo, and Oliver Lee.
My name is Peter Falanga. I'm here with the rest of our cohort, Ray Montalvo, Daniel Mackin Freeman, and David Boston. And together we're the core, missing a few people, Susan Anderson and Oliver Ngugi. But BCC TV, at least this iteration of it, has been in existence since 2013, based out of the Bud Clark Commons Houseless Service Hub. And the core of our philosophy, as it were, is to keep video art and filmmaking as an accessible medium and to highlight the playful, collaborative nature of filmmaking. In the past, we've held workshop series, but it's been about over a year since we've been able to do that. We've been focusing primarily on individual projects, but with this grant, fortunately, we'll be able to open a new round of workshops, which is 10 to 13 weeks long every Saturday from 10 to 3. We sort of give, at the beginning of each workshop, a 10-minute lesson on some sort of element of filmmaking, and the rest of the day we just go out into groups and make videos that reflect that particular lesson. At the end of the workshops, after the several weeks or so, all the projects will culminate and we'll express them at the Hollywood Theater, so for everybody to see to the public. So, and a few more words from David Boston.
Hold your applause. Thank you. Oh, my name is David Boston. Now you can clap. I'm just going to talk about my experience with BCC TV. I've known all my life that I wanted to be a filmmaker, but I didn't know where to start. And back in 2013, BCC TV gave me the opportunity to create films and give me the experience of making films. And each week, every Saturday, I would go in and we would like have a variety of workshops to where we'll be acting, doing some cinematography, along with learning about audio and editing and piecing it all together and reviewing the footage at the end of the day. So it's been a real pleasure, you know, being a part of this, you know, because it gives me something to look forward to. And I'm glad that we got this grant, and I'm glad that I'm going to be able to continue to go further on and make more films and things like that. It's a proud moment. And I also want to take the time to dedicate this moment to a friend of mine, well, a friend of ours named Russell Wagner. He passed away earlier this year, and I just wanna, in his memory, I wanna continue to, or we're gonna continue to make films and do what it is that we love, and yeah, that's pretty much it. So thank you very much, and I appreciate it.
Next up is Columbia Slough Creek College, Kimberly Sutherland, Adam Carlin, and Christina Dunn. Hi. Big crowd. So Creek College is an experimental school that bridges art education and conservation. It offers free art classes in exchange for barters that aid in restoration of the creek. Our first iteration took place this past October, along the Johnson Creek in Southeast Portland. And because of the Precipice Fund, we're able to do our second session along the Columbia Slough this coming year. For the second session, we're gonna be collaborating with NAYA, the Native American Youth and Family Center, and the Columbia Slough Watershed Council to produce 3 one-day symposiums on the slough, spanning from spring, summer to fall. The slough runs from Fairview Lake to Kelly Point Park, and I'd like to acknowledge the Multnomah and Chinook people as the rightful indigenous stewards of that land. The health of the slough has been improving due to restoration efforts over the years, but still suffers from a variety of pollutants. The Columbia Slough Creek College will offer art classes and their associated barters along the water's edge, along with a conversation among a panel of experts. That will be from a representative from NAYA, a representative from the Watershed Council, an artist, and an ecologist. And the discussion will explore questions around conservation, and it will vary in location and approach. So the first one will be a canoe conversation, the second one would be a walking conversation, and the third one will be a biking conversation. So participants get the opportunity to experience the site in different ways, and also encourages people to come to all three. The final component of the project is a publication that will highlight the diverse experiences and reflections of the participants, interviews with the panelists, and also a score for future interaction with the site. The Creek College aims to create a visceral, accessible framework for a conversation around environmental degradation and our relationship to water. And our goal is to create a broad cultural context for these groups to connect, share, and examine the needs of our waterways, and explore the way that art can be a catalyst for environmental stewardship. So we're grateful to the Precipice Fund for their support, and we hope to see you all in the water.
All right. I hope I get this pronunciation right. You have to protect, you have to correct me. Okay, Kaye Herrex. Christopher Garcia Valle, Angelica Maria Milan Lozano, and Maximiliano Carlos Rafael Francisco Martinez. Feeling basic?
Tired of seeing the same old white art?
We got you covered.
comunidad y cultura.
Between the fences where they said we shouldn't be.
Now, with third world consciousness.
Plus extra decolonizing first world consciousness.
Here to say we chant.
Trap arte.
Kai Harris.
Hey, Angelica.
Hey, I'm Texas.
What's your 2017 look like?
You know, 3 nights of lit.
Uprooting the street.
Hashtag too lit to quit.
Hey, hey, hey. Quagix.
You thought Portland was hot last summer.
Hashtag beach vibes.
Dulce como.
Cha-ching. Sussex.
Dirty like money. Cha-ching. Cha-ching.
Season finale, our line drops.
Their drops drop.
Hashtag here to stay. Shout out Sharita for all your help and support.
Christopher, Rooney, Laura, Chantel,
Acute Flesh,
Bunch of Light Guys. Jamie, Christian Dente. Wait, should we mention him?
Oh, yeah, that thing at his house.
Thing at his house.
Peter Zeminski.
Aubrey, our parents.
Wendy Redstar, Victor Maldonado, Felicia.
Melody Stevens for being Melody Stevens.
We love you. Your secrets are safe with us. There we go again, rambling.
We should wrap it up.
We dress a revolution.
Eats world.
Next up is D. Cannon, a visibility project with Dow Strom and Neil Aitken.
Hi, I'm Dow. It's Neil. Thank you to Precipice Fund. We're writers, so I'm going to read what I wrote. D. Cannon, the Visibility Project, is a pop-up library and web resource project that will showcase literary art by writers and artists of color. Our goal is to put forth an alternative literary canon, or multiple canons, in fact, that are inclusive, diverse, and multi-storied. D. Cannon wishes to challenge existing ideas of what constitutes the American literary canon, how it's formed, who gets to write it, especially in our current culture. We plan to crowdsource suggestions for books by writers and artists of color. This will include poetry, prose, and any forms of hybrid literary visual works. We'll then compile this information on a website and we'll invite writers to contribute blog posts speaking about their own personal canons and influences. Our goal here is to create a forum in which many voices contribute to the defining or undefining of the literary canon. This is, in effect, our decanonizing experiment.
I'm taller than Dow. Our decanon will consist of, in truth, multiple mini-canons with no central reference point, except that all works we talk about will be by artists and writers of color. No dead white men, in short. From our crowdsource canon, we will then select about 100 to 200 books to purchase for a physical library. We'll present these books in a portable pop-up library format, which we'd like to partner with local venues in order to host. In these spaces, we'll invite local writers and artists to present, perform their own work, and we'll encourage public discussion. Our larger hope for this project is to become a template that may be adopted in other locations, and that D-Canon, as a web resource, will expand and grow. We invite anyone who is interested, POC or not, to contribute to our crowdsourcing process. To make this easy, we've started an Instagram project where people can share photos of their own mini canons. So you can just take a shelfie or stack books or whatever. We want to see what you think is your canon. of POC authored materials. Please come up and talk to us about this or follow us on, this is the Instagram account, at DCannon Project, all one word. Thank you.
Field of View, an artist residency program for artists with disabilities. Carissa Burkett, Lauren Moran, and Zemi Barr, and several of the artist collaborators are here today as well.
This is Lauren Moran, this is Emmy Barr. And we have three of our artists are gonna be our artists in residence this year for our first project. This project is allowing six artists with disabilities to have an artist residency at a site in Portland. We have six sites, OMSI, the Independent Publishing Resource Center, King's School, the Pixie Project, Holiday Park Retirement Community, and I'm missing one. And Soma Space. So six artists tonight. We have Larry Subnett, a painter and a writer, will be at the Independent Publishing Resource Center. And Sony Hamilton, a painter, ceramicist, and writer, will be at the King Schools, and Olga Shapina will be at Pixie Project. These are all artists who have been really committed and devoted to their practice, and work in a studio called Project Grow, working on their practice 5 days a week, 5 hours every day. They're very committed to their practice. This project is allowing them to take their work into new spaces and new communities. They're getting paid to be artists. They will be paid for their residency, and they will get paid to make art in new communities and bring their art into new visible spaces. Zemi Barr will then be curating a show of all the work that's created over the residencies throughout the course of the year. I'm really excited. Thank you so much. Thank you. Next up is Futel, Old Phones, New Secrets. Carl Anderson, Jason Plum, Alex Norman, Elijah St. Clair, and Debbie Wager.
Hello. I'm Carl. This is Alex. This is Debbie. And we're here to represent Futel. We install payphones in public locations, which are free to use, and they provide free phone calls, as well as a menu of surprising things to do. Most important is the free phone calls, but we also offer one-touch dialing to the mayor. Thank you. Interactive audio art. Several services and fun things to do and surprising things to do, but also live operator assistance in case you need information, or if you don't have someone to talk to, we can provide someone you can talk to. And we also provide free phone service to Right to Dream on Burnside Street. So in general, we're a mix between providing a public service and an artistic experience. We have several phones which have been available 24 hours a day in Portland throughout 2016. And with this grant, we're going to install several new phones and develop some new interactive features. And we're always interested in locations for phones, publicly accessible and time accessible locations. So thank you.
Locusts, a post-queer nation zine. Kevin Holden and Damian DeMayo.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Kevin Holden. I am one of the collaborators of Locusts, a post-queer nation zine. Damian cannot be here tonight. He's in Santa Fe. I would To begin, I would like to acknowledge again that we are on the stolen and occupied lands of the Chinook and Multnomah peoples. It is important to acknowledge the indigenous peoples of this land because what matters in contemporary art, what matters in art today, tonight, is contingent on this fact that we are occupying the lands that are not, that do not belong to us, to anyone. The reality of this situation and the current social and political environment we have been forced into has necessitated the insurgency in work that Demian, myself, and the artists in Locust are presenting along with our fellow grantees and artists throughout the region. Because Demian cannot be here tonight, I would like to read something that he wanted me to share with you all. Thank you, PICA, for recognizing the importance of Locust, a post-queer nation zine. Regretfully, I am not able to be in your company tonight, but I am celebrating nonetheless under a full moon in Santa Fe. I would also like to congratulate the fellow grantees, and I am thankful for the art community we have in spite of the fact that non-white, non-male, non-queer artists still face marginalization, which means we must work multiple times harder to find traction in the community while simultaneously creating spaces for all of our work to evolve and expand beyond the limited scope of what society deems as sufficient, historical, and valuable. We must never lose heart and remain strong for ourselves and for one another, because at any turn the very future our ancestors fought for could turn against us. So we offer you the zine as a companion of love, honesty, mercy, anger, anxiety, humor, dreams, desires, and something beyond the American understanding of sovereignty and hope. With love, Demian. And with that, thank you.
Miss Anthology, Melody Stevens, Matt Carlisle, and Emily Lewis.
And we make them on a regular basis, but because comics as a medium have the rare ability to function within popular culture, literature, academia, and contemporary art. They tell intimate tales incorporating theory and perspective on current events and are a versatile tool for artists to communicate their ideas to the masses.
We are creating this anthology with that power of narrative voice and visibility in mind. And within the context of comics having been primarily generated by white heterosis males, we believe in creating equitable spaces for culturally and economically marginalized female and genderqueer youth to access sequential art as a platform from which to project their own experiences and expressions. We will also explore the potential for that platform to move critical art practices beyond the realm of the gallery. We're extremely honored that we've been selected as recipients for the Precipice Fund and are looking forward to this upcoming year to create new and exciting artistic opportunities for young artists, writers, and content creators.
Physical education, Allie Hankins, Keon Gaskin, Takahiro Yamamoto, and Lou Yip. Keon Gaskin isn't here this evening. He's somewhere else in the world. We don't know. I don't know. So physical education, in short, is the four of us, and we are
interested in sort of facilitating or cultivating situations where we can bring interdisciplinary artists together. We four have a practice in performance, but also in visual art as well. And we've been interested in really confronting the perceived messiness or illegibility of performance and performance-based work. And so we host a series of events to sort of bring people into the room together to kind of hash it out over drinks, over food, in a very casual, relaxed environment, hopefully.
Think of it as a place to talk. The reading group really is there to incite dialogue around performance, a way to get language to come out of our mouths or into our heads around what we're seeing and experiencing. We, along with the reading group and performances that we put on, we also give out workshops and have been doing artist shares and are just really interested in bringing people together to talk about the materiality of the body. And we work with other artist-run spaces because we don't have a space, we roam.
Oh. We have an event coming up this month that we are very excited about. Besides the whole year programming that we have next year. So come over. Thank you.
Portland filmmakers and Boathouse Micro Cinema, Matt McCormick and Chris Green.
So the Boathouse is a decommissioned fireboat station that for the past, there it is right there, that's back in the day. For the past, 30 years now, it's been a collective artist studio. I've been kind of running the ship now for 16 years and been very kind of heavy on the filmmaking and video maker side of the arts. Over the years, we've had a lot of events at this space. Maybe some of you have been to them. There was the Bounce Castle Party, Haunted House 1 year, lots of film screenings, and almost 20 years ago was the site of the first ever PICA Dada Ball, as a matter of fact. So cool history. One of the spaces inside, used to be actually the bunk room of the firefighters who lived there, has been a photo studio for a while, and the two photographers who have been inhabiting that space are on their way out. And Chris and I thought, as the remaining two artists there, thought, what if we, instead of finding a new artist to move in that space, just turned it into a little movie theater? And so that's what we did. We're turning it into a temporary micro cinema. But then, in the thinking of that, we thought, in addition to, let's not just make it a micro cinema, let's sort of step it up a notch. So we came up with this idea of Portland filmmakers, which Chris will tell you about.
Yeah. The Portland filmmakers screening program is going to be our marquee program of local Portland filmmakers, just like it sounds. It'll be once a week, every Wednesday night from February to May, trying to build some community amongst filmmakers here. We're going to have people making documentaries, to people who make experimental video, established artists, to people just starting out, and probably some student screening works also. Should be great. We hope you guys come out. Thanks a lot.
Sanctuary Sunday, Coco Madrid, Emily Laurel, and Crystal Perez.
Thank you.
to try not to cry first.
I'm Crystal. Sanctuary Sunday is Coco's brainchild. I got pulled on board a couple years ago as a video assistant. Sorry, close.
We'll talk about yourself a little bit.
I am a Cuban transplant from Miami. I moved here about 6 years ago, and Sanctuary Sunday is probably one of the first times that I felt really included and really safe in a comfortable space. Coco really creates, it's always held in like an old church, and there's just no better place for it because it's really a place where you can feel like you're being healed and just like really coming to terms with your spiritual self. And I really get to express a lot visually in this space, and just am really excited to do a lot more. I'm really excited about this opportunity. I'm really excited about just being able to bring a lot more people into this project because it is something that we really want the community to come and be a part of.
Thank you, Crystal. She's been a great collaborator, and I feel like she's a strong partner for this project that we're gonna do next year. I'm super nervous. So I'm just literally gonna read everything itself. I just wanted to thank you so much for this opportunity. It's been really, it's been a reality check and validation for all the work that I've been doing. Being noticed and rewarded for my efforts makes this labor of love truly worth it. My work, of course, cannot have been done without the help of a lot of important people, including Crystal. So I'd just like to take this time to thank those people. They have all directly helped move Sanctuary Sunday forward in one way or another. So I would like to say thank you to Mike Jethka, Tim Westcott, Dave Mosier, Matt Henderson and the ex-church family, Cody Brandt, Mike Irwin, and my best friend, Priya Rouse. Sanctuary Sunday is a live, interactive, audio-visual presentation that invites the public to worship via audio-visual stimulus. This ongoing series invites participants to commune together to receive a sermon of the day, which is delivered by way of audio-visual performances. This is a high concept version of Sanctuary Sunday that we're going to be presenting next year. It's basically to provide a church service that gathers those faithful to the healing properties of live manipulated visuals combined with ambient experimental music in a sacred space. Sanctuary Sunday draws on the idea of audiovisual performances serving as sermons that are delivered in a sacred space. The audience or congregants are invited to experience the performance as though they were at a church service. Unlike many traditional church services, however, Sanctuary Sunday welcomes an inclusive audience regardless of age, gender, race, or belief. This interactive performance event also serves as a platform to create space for ambient experimental artists who have been marginalized in the broader ambient experimental music scene. This iteration of Sanctuary Sunday will be the first of this series that will feature the work of solely female identified artists and artists of color. After realizing that I didn't see many people in these rooms that I've been attending for 15 years, I thought it was high time to give some space to the people that have been marginalized in this community. This Sanctuary Sunday will take place in a non-traditional space. Shout out to Oakland and the survivors and victims. Without those non-traditional spaces, I probably wouldn't be standing here today. There's a lot more to say, but I'm not going to go into it. We have a great amount of artists that are going to be contributing to this project. And I just want to thank the Precipice Fund so much for helping me realize my dreams.
Thank you. up is Spaceness, Julia Barbie, Matthew Supley, and Allison Jean Cole.
I'm Julia Barbie, this is my husband Matthew, and our third partner Allison is not here with us. I'm gonna read because I'm not great at this. Spaceness came about partly because Allison and I were working on a crystallized sugar suit that we would travel into space with that didn't work out. But as we were working on this project, we just came up with this term spaceness and thought it would be funny to create an event around work that was kind of nebulous but had something to do with time or the unknown. And we met Allison actually down in Joshua Tree during a high desert test sites project, and we really liked the atmosphere that experience created, and we wanted to have some sort of retreat-like intimate space that we could create here in the Northwest. So we chose the Sou'wester Lodge as our site, which is adjacent to Astoria. And this is actually a shot of the space there. It's an old lodge from the 1800s with a trailer park, and we just threw out a call to artists through Craigslist and posters in grocery stores, and ended up with kind of a fun collection of random people the first year. And since then, we've kind of turned into a more mature event, I think. But we really appreciate gaining sponsorship from the Hollywood Theater and Stumptown and different places, and we just are really grateful to have the Precipice as a part of that list for us this year, and we're excited to be able to give artist fees to all of our artists this year, so we're excited for that.
When will it be?
It will be February 24th through the 26th. Please come out, it'll be awesome.
Yeah, this is going to be the third year that we're doing this, and I just want to thank all the artists that have been with us for the past 2 years, and we're really excited about the group we have this time, and I think we even have some people in attendance who were participating artists, so it's we're really grateful to you guys as well, because I don't think we'd be standing up here if you didn't help us the last 2 years. So everybody, you're welcome to come. It's an all-ages event.
It's free.
Everyone welcome. It's free. It's February 24th, 25th, and 26th in CB, Washington at the Sou'wester Lodge.
Thank you through photography, Melanie Flood and Chelsea Crossan.
Well, there are a lot of people here. I'm going to imagine everyone naked.
Same.
Hi, I'm Melanie Flood, and I'm a graduate student in the Contemporary Art Studio Practice Program at PSU. Shout out Kristen Kennedy and Julie Freeney. And I'm also director of Melanie Flood Projects.
Hi guys, I'm Chelsea Crossett. I recently graduated from PNCA with my master's in critical theory, and I'm now the programs coordinator at New Space Center for Photography. Thinking Through Photography is our collaborative curatorial project that's hosted at Melanie Flood Projects, which is an artist-run gallery space in downtown Portland. This project began in fall of 2015 with local artist Lee Anderson, and the series is a comprehensive survey of contemporary photographic practices conveyed through exhibitions, artist talks, studio visits, interviews, and readings.
This program highlights experimental and diverse approaches to image making that expand the language surrounding photography, while also unveiling progressive work by local artists in the Pacific Northwest and beyond. This generous award will enable us to pay exhibiting artists and to complete this 2-year exploration of contemporary photo. The next exhibition is in January 2017 with Maria Antelman, followed by Drew Donovan in April 2017 during Portland Photo Month. So I hope we'll see you all in 2017. Thank you so much.
Next is Una Gallery, Mercedes Orozco Barrero, Claire Blair Crispin, Anthony Ellick, and Opal Grace Jones.
Thank you so much. I was gonna read this thing,
But I think the only thing I'm going to read from it is that we are art space hoping to serve POC, queer communities, femme and gender non-conforming artists. The reason that I'm no longer going to read this is because I'm mostly just very excited to, we are very excited. This is a team effort. We're so excited because so many of these projects are exactly the type of thing that we created this space for. We want to do, God, I should refer to this. we want to get crazy in this space and create incredible projects and host incredible projects. The political landscape definitely demands it. For example, February, we are starting with an art as resistance group show, which our call is open for, but we're also, I'm just so excited to really get to know all of you, all of the grantees and other artists out there that have projects that are exactly why we wanted this space to be available. So, find us.
Where are you?
We're downtown. We are by the Park Blocks, Broadway and Flanders. It's part of the Everett Station Lofts. It's a really flexible space. We have like movable walls and we're just so excited. And thank you so much for everything that everyone's doing and the really amazing stuff. I think the key thing is this is why we're doing it for all of this stuff. So come over, do it.
Our next grantees could not be here in this moment. UReTV, which stands for United Republic of the African Diaspora Television, includes artists Sharita Town and Shawnee Peters. Shawnee Peters is now. Sharita is going to be here at 9 p.m. after she teaches a class, so you should find her when she gets here to learn more, but I do have a few things that they put together that I want to share. We are Shawnee Peters and Sharita Town, the creators of the artist collective URead Press, United Republic of the African Diaspora. URead Press is grounded in shared inquiry and affinity for the African diaspora, self-determination, audiovisual media, and DIY mobile printmaking strategies. URead produces free transmedia events emphasizing a local group's connection to a broader and deeper diasporic community across continents and history. In 2017 and 2018, URead Press is launching its first long-term project, URead TV. URead TV will draw together contemporary audiovisual works by and for the African diaspora that can contribute to intra-diasporic dialogue, unity, and imagination. URead TV screenings will be marketed towards, viewed, and discussed by Black communities in each of the five regionally specific cities it is set to travel to: New York, Cleveland, Oakland, Portland, and New Orleans. We will then travel this program in its first year throughout the United States, then later abroad. All programs will be free of charge. Some of our goals for the URead TV are as follows: to provide space to gather and share art and creative processes within Portland while looking to a larger inclusivity that fosters global visibility and dialogue for Africa diasporic expressions, innovations, and intersectionality. To offer translation and subtitling to previously monolingual audiovisual work. And to create a publication that synthesizes the diversity of our programming and Afro-diasporic collective goals. Thank you for this support. URead TV is in the works with Black Love, Shawnee Peters, and Sharita Town, United Republic of the African Diaspora. And our final grantee of the evening, last but certainly not least, is YGB, Young Gifted. Sarah Levine and Natalie Figueroa and Lamar Lewis.
it going? I'm Lamar Leroy. All I do with YGB is DJ, so I provide the music. When we started a little bit over a year ago, it was a party that was in disguise. We were a community building group trying to find and hold spaces for Black and brown people, and also change the narrative of what a Black party meant. No more of the ratchet things, just like, oh, it's all cursing and misogyny, and also letting people know that it's cool to hang out with Black and brown people. We won't hurt you, we're fun people. So, thank you. With what we've gained from the Precipice Fund, we're planning on doing an exchange, basically. Bringing artists from Chicago and artists from Portland and mixing the places. We're focusing on music, visual arts, and dance. Look at that. I don't have all the words because I was just told about this a couple days ago, but that's essentially it. We're just trying to bring people here and bring people there and let people know that we're all great and cool and we can do so many cool things together. Thank you.
Artists, to PICA staff, to all of our volunteers and interns, to all of you here in the room supporting, we are now transitioning to our party. So we're gonna ask you to help us by picking up your chair, if you're in a chair, and wait, just one second. and we're gonna place them over in this back corner where I'm pointing to by the storage closet, and our staff will get those into our closet. We'll clear the space, because we hope for lots of dancing. There's a bar, there's food. Shannon Funches of Light Asylum is about to start DJing. DJ Cliff is on at 10. So please stick with us. Thank you so much again, Ali Perlotti, Caligram Foundation, Warhol Foundation, PICA, and all of you.
Yeah,